Good afternoon, everybody. I, Dr. Yogita Parashar, consultant obs and gynae at Manipal Hospital, Dwarka, give you a very warm welcome to join for our webinar session today. It includes first trimester screening and early anomaly scan. The early anomaly scan part will be presented by my good colleague, Dr. Gaurav, who is a consultant radiologist out here. All right, so we start with the first trimester screening. As we all know, the safe motherhood idea, which have been now widely propagated by our government, it includes giving a good antenatal care to all our antenatal patients. An important objective in this antenatal care is good antenatal screening methods. Now, the aim of antenatal care should be focused and individualized to screen the conditions which are treatable, which need constant vigilance and surveillance, and which may require urgent management, we should be able to identify such conditions. Every obstetrician and gynecologist should be aware of the recent advances and should incorporate new investigations in screening methods, diagnostic modalities, and management options for early detection, counseling, and treatment of the conditions. Now, we should all know what is screening. Now, screening is the process of identifying apparently healthy people who may be at increased risk of a particular disease or a condition. Screening does not mean that the person or the fetus is actually having or carrying that disease, but it just identifies the population which is at increased risk of carrying that disease. Now, our ideal screening test, ideally, we all want it to be 100% sensitive, 100% specific. It should give a 100% positive predictive value with a no false positive and a no false negative, in which the sensitivity is basically the ability to detect individuals with presence of a target condition. Specificity is the ability to detect individuals who are completely disease-free. False positive are individuals who are not carrying the disease, but somehow are detected with it. Least is the false positive, more is the test sensitive. And false negative, these are the individuals who have the disease, but they are detected free of it. The least is the false negative, more is the test specific. Now, the first trimester screening, we would like to identify any anomaly in the fetus as early as possible. So, the earlier first, the second trimester screening and second trimester anomaly scan used to be our main major factor, but we try to decrease the gestational age so that we can detect these anomalies in the first trimester itself. Now, the components of first trimester screening, it includes screening for any aneuploidy or chromosomal defects, screening for fetal structure anomaly, screening for any risk of early preeclampsia or fetal growth retardation, multi-fetal gestation screening for chorionicity and prediction of any related complications, detection and screening for various genetic disorders, and screening for preterm labor as well with the help of cervical. Now, the first trimester screening, what are the important components in it? First is the maternal serum markers, which we commonly know as dual marker. It includes the chemicals like free beta HCG and PAPA, which is a pregnancy-associated plasma protein A. Second modality is 2D or 3D ultrasound, by which we do a nuchal translucency scan in between 11 weeks to 13 plus 6 weeks. Doppler is also included nowadays, and this is to detect, this gives the prediction for any early onset preeclampsia and future fetal growth retardation, in which we see if there is any diastolic notching in the uterine artery. This combined screening, including the maternal age, the nuchal scan, and the dual marker, it is known as combined screening method. Now, which all are the high-risk group in which these aneuploidies are common? First of all, if the maternal age is more than 35 years at the expected date of birth, if there is any history of teratogen exposure, example teratogenic drugs like antiepileptics, isotretinoin, ACE inhibitors, radiations including X-rays and CT scan, If there is any history of high grade fever with rash, any history of exposure to medical conditions including diabetes and thyroid, if there is any history of intake of any abortifacient drugs in the first trimester, if there is any history of consanguinity or same community marriage, if there is any history of pregnancy for fetal anomaly, if there is any history of previous child born with major congenital defect, mental retardation or hearing disability. We also have to look for any genetic disease in the family. Now, what all are the factors which are included in aneuploidy screening? First of all, the maternal age. The more is the maternal age, the more is the risk of aneuploidy in the fetus. Second is the fetal heart rate. As we know, the fetal heart rate is slightly higher in trisomy 21 and much higher in trisomy 13, but it is slightly lower in trisomy 18. Other serum biochemistry marker, like the dual marker which involves beta-HCG and PAPI. Then there is nuchal translucency scan and new ultrasound markers, which Dr. Gaurav is going to talk to you about shortly. Now, what is combined first trimester screening? It is the new non-invasive evaluation which combines maternal blood screening test plus the ultrasound evaluation of the fetus for nuchal translucency and nasal bone plus maternal age. It identifies the risk for specific chromosomal abnormalities including Down syndrome and trisomy 18 and 13. It gives a really good detection rate of as high as 93% to 96% for trisomy 21 and 75% for trisomy 18 and 13, with a very less false positive rate of just 3%. Now, what is the importance of dual marker? Dual marker is generally conducted between 10th to 13th week, and sometimes few obstetricians they advise it between 9th week to 13 plus 6 weeks also. It measures the level of beta-HCG and PAPI. It screens the fetus with chromosomal anomalies. When we screen these fetus, this means that these fetus may be at increased risk of carrying these trisomies, but 100% detection can be done only with further testing with chorionic villi sampling or amniocentesis. The beta-HCG value generally falls in the range of 25,700 to 2,88,000 milli-international unit per ml between 8 to 12 week. And PAP A value is generally more than 0.5 multiple of medians. Now, the importance of human chorionic gonadotropin as risk predictor when it is included in dual marker screening, why it is important, we all need to know. This glycoprotein is made up of two alpha and beta subunits. The free beta subunit, it is widely used as for screening as component of dual marker, although both alpha and beta, both subunits increase during the first trimester, but more specific is the free beta subunit. It increases in fetus with aneuploidy starting at the end of first trimester, and it continues till the second trimester, making it useful for both the first and second trimester screening. The multiple of median of free beta HCG in aneuploidy 21 is between 2.06 and 2.64. Now, PAPA as risk predictor. PAPA or pregnancy-associated plasma protein A, it was first discovered by Lin in 1974. It is a highly potent protease for insulin-like growth factor binding protein 4 and 5, which actually inhibits the insulin-like growth factor. Now, proteolysis acts as positive regulator of IGF availability, as they are not further able to degrade IGF factor. And this insulin-like growth factor, it as it mediates the trophoblastic invasion of decidua and modulates transport of glucose and amino acids in placenta. Whenever PAPA is raised, it generally indicates that the baby may suffer with fetal growth retardation also. The low values of PAPA. Insufficient since tissue draw for blastic development and function, it leads to abnormal placental secretion of main placental protein. The measurement of PAPA in first trimester of pregnancy is part of combined screening in first trimester for various chromosomopathies as per the recommendation of Fetal Medicine Foundation. This PAPA generally increases as the pregnancy progresses, but the low levels of PAPA, which is less than 0.4 multiple of medium in first trimester screening, they have predictive value for fetal growth retardation, as we just talked. Whenever the level of PAPA is low, this decreases the availability of insulin-like growth factor because of its proteolysis. And this leads to more of fetal growth retardation, preeclampsia, premature birth, and stillbirth, as PAPA has a role in trophoblastic invasion of decidua, cell mitosis, and differentiation. It also has an immunosuppressive effect in placenta and inhibition of coagulation. Now, we generally give it as a risk ratio. A risk ratio of 1:10 to 1:250, it indicates a high risk. What do you mean by that? That every 10 pregnant female in which this evaluation is being done, in fetus which have the same value, the risk of the fetus, one fetus will be, in every 10 fetus with the same value of PAPA, one fetus will have actually have this anomaly. So these indicates a high risk. These patients are offered prenatal genetic testing to exclude chromosomopathies. Risk ratio of more than 1:1000, these indicates a low risk. All these three trisomies, they are associated with increased maternal age, increased fetal nuchal translucency, and decreased serum PAPA. Now, the difference between all these trisomies, when we apply all these screening methods, is we see the differences. Fetal nuchal translucency is generally higher in trisomies 18 and 13 than in 21. Serum PAPA is lower in trisomies 18 and 13 as compared with trisomy 21. And free serum beta HCG in trisomy 21 is high, whereas in trisomies 18 and 13, it is lower. The fetal heart rate in trisomy 13 is much higher compared to trisomy 18 and 21. Thank you. This concludes my talk. Now, Dr. Gaurav is going to take over to discuss about early anomaly.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Dr. Gaurav Malhotra, consultant radiology and imaging at Manipal Hospital, Dwarka. Today, we are going to talk about early anomaly or NT scan. Now, my talk is going to cover the following points. Why we need an early anomaly scan, timing of early anomaly scan, what is nuchal scan, that includes NT, NB, DVF, tricuspid regurgitation, and a newer marker, intracranial translucency. Now, this part of the talk we are going to focus today, the anatomical scan and systematic evaluation of the fetus, we are going to take care in the next lecture. And in the end, we'll see what to achieve in future. Now, need for early anomaly scan. Now, we have ever-changing and emerging new concepts every day. We started off earlier as an anomaly scan at 18 to 20 weeks. And then we thought that why we can't pick up the anomalies earlier than this. We started off with early anomaly scan, which is done as 11 to 14 weeks or 11 to 13 weeks, 6 days precisely, wherein our target is to find the life-threatening anomalies that are picked up early, or at least we get some clues to anomalies so that we can do follow-up repeat scans. Now, even if I'm suspicious about a fetus at around 11 to 14 weeks, I still have a window period of 4 weeks before the anomaly scan. So we can repeatedly scan the patients in which we are suspicious. What started off by measuring accurate CRL and a nuchal scan, and then we moved on to the fetal anatomy and studying the structural defects. Now, all these, they are included in early anomaly scan. Now, the early anomaly scan, it is used to predict the outcome in preeclampsia, diabetes, and preterm deliveries, along with the serum biochemistry correlation, which Madam has already talked about. And we actually have different prenatal screening protocols. I always start my talk with the basic thing, and that is the crown rump length. It is measured in the sagittal view of the fetus in neutral horizontal position. Crown, that is skin above the parietal bone, and rump, skin inferior to the tip of the sacrum, is measured. It should be between 45 to 84 mm for NT scan. Ideally, it should be more than 56 mm. It is used to standardize the biochemistry, that is the maternal serum results. Now, why I always focus on a good CRL is because that is the baseline for our serum biochemistry. If you are not getting a good CRL, our results are going to vary. Another thing, the CRL has to be in this window of 45 to 84 mm. Even if we have a CRL of 43 mm or 86 mm, we are not going to go in for a NT scan. Now let's see two examples. These are the two fetuses. Gestation age is 12 weeks, 6 days. We do the CRL. There is adequate depth and magnification. The CRL axis is almost at a degree of 30 degrees with the horizontal. It should be as parallel to horizontal as possible. And if it is vertical or it is more than 30 degrees, we are not going to get an accurate CRL. Now, we can see very clearly the fetus is at 12 weeks, 6 days, and our ultrasound age is corresponding to 13 weeks, 3 days. Here, we have a fetus with gestation age of 12 weeks, 2 days, and our ultrasound age is around 12 weeks, 5 days. So 2 to 3 days of variation, even with a very good CRL, is still possible. Now let's see this example. We have a fetus in which we are measuring a CRL. It is almost vertical, the angle is almost 60 degrees. We get a CRL of 65 mm. We wait for some time, around 5 to 10 minutes. Now the fetus is more horizontal and we get a CRL of 60 mm. So you can very clearly see this is not the right way to take a CRL, because we can get variation even in the same fetus. Scans done 5 minutes apart, that there is a 5 mm variation of CRL, and all my serum biochemistry depends on that. Let's talk about the timing of early anomic scan. The timing is broadly classified into 11 to 12 weeks, 12 to 13 weeks, and 13 to 14 weeks. Now let's see what each week has to offer. Now in 11 to 12 weeks, NT can be measured, yes. The structural details are difficult, and the gestation age and biometry, if they are not corresponding with each other, then biometry generally may turn out to be less. And if it is less than 11 weeks, we are not going to do a proper NT scan, and we are going to send the patient back and call the patient again. The 12 to 13 weeks is the best time to do the early anomaly scan. There is horizontal orientation of fetus. The NT is best visualized. The structural details are good. And gestation age and biometry, even if they are not corresponding with each other, we still have 2 to 3 days window, and we are well within the range of doing a good NT. Hence, I always tell my gynae people to send the patient for an NT scan in 12 to 13 weeks. In 13 to 14 weeks, there is vertically oriented fetus, which is not good for NT. The structural details are better visualized, definitely, because the fetus has grown. And gestational age and biometry, if they vary, it can be more. That is, it can go up to 14 weeks, 3 days or 5 days. Now in biometry, we generally take two readings. One is CRL. We also take a BPD, or a FL can also be used. So we take both the readings for an averaging effect. Well, now what is nuchal scan? Nuchal scan includes nuchal translucency, nasal bone, ductus venosus flow, tricuspid regurgitation, and intracranial translucency. Nuchal translucency. It is a collection of fluid under the skin behind the neck of fetuses at 11 weeks to 13 weeks, 6 days, that can be measured by the ultrasound. It is measured between the CRL of 45 to 84 mm by expert ultrasonologists or sonographers. The window has to be between 45 to 84 mm, I've already stated. Now, what are the criteria for a good nuchal NT scan? Appropriate depth and magnification, true mid-serrated section, neutral fetal position, calipers are to be placed on-to-on or inside-to-inside, and maximum translucency is to be measured, and thin nuchal membrane should be identified. Let's see what each and everything means. Appropriate depth and magnification means, ideally, only the fetal head and the upper thorax should be included. A true mid-serrated section means tip of the nasal bone should be visualized and rectangular shape of palate should be defined. Neutral fetal position. The head is in line with the spine and there is a clear space between the chin and the thorax. Calipers are placed on to on. It means it has to be inner to inner and it has to be a straight line in erect position. Maximum translucency. It is the widest particle lucency measured and a thin mucous membrane is seen clearly. Thin mucous membrane. It is important to distinguish between the fetal skin and the amniotic membrane. We have to fulfill all the six criteria. Now these are two examples. Let's see if we are fulfilling the criteria. The first one is appropriate depth and magnification. The fetal head and abdomen are visualized. Yes, it has to be a true mid-cervical section. The tip of the nasal bone is visualized and there is a pocket of fluid between the fetal chin and the thorax. Ideally, the length of this pocket should be at least equal to the rectangular shape of palate or more than that. In fact, people say that the tip of the nose and the thorax should actually make a straight line for a good amount of flexion. Then the calipers are placed on to on or inside to inside. In GE machines or Voluson, we have a box, we can place it over here and it automatically gets the maximum reading. Otherwise, we have to take the maximum reading and we know that we are going in the right direction. Thin mucous membrane has to be well identified and it is to be differentiated from the amniotic membrane. If we are confused, we have to wait for the fetal movement. Now, one more clue is that we should be very well able to see the diencephalon or the future thalamus. Now, whenever I see this section, I know that I am in the right plane. We should be able to see intracranial translucency also, which I'm going to talk about very shortly. The frontal process of the maxilla should not be visualized. This is the perfect way to do a proper anti-scan. And we cannot compromise on any of the six points which I have already discussed. On interpretation, the median and the 95th percentile at the CRL of 45 mmR 1.2 and 2.1 mm, the respective values at CRL of 84 mm are 1.9 and 2.7 mm. General values of 3 mm or more are to be applied cautiously. Whenever my NT goes beyond 2.5 or 3, I get really, really suspicious and I actually search for the anomalies. Actually, I study anatomy and I see all my other parameters very carefully. Normograms of different CRL are also available. We actually have for every CRL, we have a NT value. And we have got proper normograms available. Now it is increased in chromosomal abnormalities, non-chromosomal syndromes, cardiac defects, fetal anemia and hypoproteinemia, fetal infections such as TORCH and parvovirus. Let's see a few examples. We can very well see the NT is increased over here. It is not looking normal. NT is basically a fluid overload. So we have to be very careful. The fetus has to be in proper position. And we are not going to increase NT if we are taking all the sections properly. Again, in this fetus, we can see there is skin edema all throughout. All over there is skin edema and NT is actually reaching 7.4 mm. So we know both these fetuses are abnormal and aneuploidies. Let's talk about nasal bone now. It appears at a CRL of 42 mm. The ultrasound transducer should be parallel to the nose. An equal sign should be visualized. That means a top line is skin, the bottom is the nasal bone, and the third line is the cartilaginous tip of the nose should be seen. We have to be very careful that the echogenicity of the nasal bone should be more than the skin overlying it. We have to see the presence or the absence of nasal bone. And even if we are seeing a nasal bone, we have to mention if it is normal or hypoplastic. A normal value of nasal bone is around 3 mm for the first trimester. I have just taken this example to show you how nasal bone looks like and what is equal to sign. This is the tip of the nose, this is the skin overlying it, and this is the nasal bone proper. So we have to see this is equal to, we have to see the cartilaginous tip of the nose as well. This is the proper section where we can see all the three things and we can actually see is equal to sign. The presence or the absence or the normal versus hypoplastic nasal bone should be documented. The absence or non-ossified nasal bone is strongly linked to Down syndrome. It's a marker of other syndrome associated with mid-face hypoplasia. Let's see two examples. Look at this example. I can see a nasal bone, yes, but then the echogenicity of this nasal bone is not more than the overlying skin. This is an abnormally looking fetus and I get suspicious about it. Look at this NT, this is also increased. So I know that yes, I'm dealing with an abnormal fetus. Here, there is a clear-cut absent nasal bone seen and there is no is equal to sign seen. So I know I'm dealing with a fetus with Down syndrome, probably. Let's talk about ductus venosus flow now. Sagittal section of the abdomen is magnified. We put a color dotter on the area of maximum eliasm or the brightest signal. The PW sample of width 0.5 to 1 mm is to be taken, and isonation angle should be less than 30. Now, DVF is basically a shunt. It is a shunt which carries the oxygenated blood from the umbilical vein. The normal waveform is a high velocity during ventricular systole called as S wave, and diastole, which is called as D wave, with a forward flow during atrial contraction, that is called the A wave. Now, abnormal DV flow means the reversal of A wave flow. Abnormal DVF is associated with increased risk of Down syndrome, preeclampsia, and gestational diabetes. Now, if we have an abnormal NT and an abnormal DVF, it is a pointer towards the cardiac anomaly. We should be very careful about it, and we have to avoid contamination. Let's see this example. It's a proper magnified view of the abdomen, sagittal view, and we can see my area of maximum eliasing. So I'm going to put my cursor over here, and I put my cursor, we can see the S wave, the D wave, and the A wave all have to be on the same side of the baseline. This is very important. Now the abnormal DVF looks something like this. Now we have an A wave, which is reversal. This is the A wave reversal. These are the various patterns of abnormal DVF. Now we first have an absent A wave, then we have a reversed A wave, then we have something called an M-shaped wave. All these things we are able to see once we know that how to look at the DVF every time, how to avoid contamination. Believe me, you're not going to miss an A wave reversal if you are regularly and religiously doing DVF in all the patients. Let's talk about tricuspid regurgitation now. It is seen in magnified apical four chamber view. The PW sample is across the tricuspid wall of 2 to 3 mm is put. We do not use the color Doppler because there is a lot of artifacts which are covering the tricuspid wall. Isonation angle should be less than 30 degrees to the interventricular septum. A normal tricuspid wall flow velocity is less than 60 centimeters per second. In tricuspid regurgitation, the velocity is more than 60 centimeters per second. Now, it is associated with chromosomal aneuploidies and cardiac defects if NT is raised. So if my NT is raised, I move on to see the DVF, I move on to see the tricuspid regurgitation. My baseline NT is very, very important, and I get really suspicious if DVF and tricuspid regurgitation are both abnormal. Let's see how it looks. Now these are two examples again which we have done. Now we can very well see that there is no waveform which is going beyond 60 centimeters per second. So there is no TR. You will never miss abnormal TR if you are regularly doing it. Now look at this, it is almost going up to 80 centimeters per second or even 1 meter per second. So this is how a normal waveform looks like, and we have to see, we have to put a cursor properly, we have to take a line from the spine, we know which is the left ventricle, we know which is the right ventricle, and if you magnify it, you are able to get it very easily. Now let's talk of the newer marker, intracranial translucency. Now it is a concept given by Robin Choi of Germany. Now Robin Choi and Professor Nikolaitis of Fetal Medicine Foundation, they published a paper in 2010 in Journal of Obs and Gyne, wherein the fourth ventricle presents as IT. They said the fourth ventricle presents as the IT between the brainstem and the choroid plexus, and it's easily visible. The AP diameter of CRL 45 mm is 1.5 mm, and at CRL of 84 mm is 2.5 mm. Now it is used for the prediction, or it is a marker of the future spina bifida. The obliteration of intracranial translucency tells us that everything is not right. Let's see these examples. Now this I already told you, this is a future thalamus, this is a future midbrain, this black line is a future brainstem, and this is a future medulla oblongata. Now this white line is the posterior aspect of the brainstem. This black thing is the intracranial translucency, behind which there is a choroid in the fourth ventricle. This black line again is the future cisterna magna, and the white line in the last is the occipital bone. So this is again making an equal to sign. We have to measure this in every patient. We have to be very alert. If we can see architectural distortion, or if we can see loss of IT, we are heading for a future spina bifida. Let's see some other cases. Now, what do we see? We see in the basal bone. Is it seen? Yes, okay, it can be seen. What about the IT? Yes, IT is also looking good. And what about the NT? NT is also looking okay. So is there something abnormal with the fetus? Yes, there is something abnormal. We are not able to see the rectangular shape of the palate. and this fetus later on moved on to be a cleft palate. This is another case with the increased mucoid translucency where we cannot see the nasal bone, NT is increased, it is 3.6 mm and we are not able to see a good ID. So I know this is a fetus with a Down syndrome, I'm heading for a fetus with Down syndrome. Now this again we did, this abnormally looking fetus, not a very good section, but I know that this fetus is abnormal. When we zoomed in, we saw that there was the loss of cranial bones, there were no cranial bones and all the brain matter was lying outside. So this is a acrania, exencephaly, anencephaly sequence. Now we have to pick this up before the anencephaly. Why should we wait for anencephaly to appear? We already know by 12 to 13 weeks we can see the cranial bones and we should be very alert. Now see something, this is something interesting. I see it very, very common in my practice. If you see multiple lines over here, what is this? Now we put a color and we see, oh, this is the cord. Now how to measure NT in such cases? You can see, you can take the NT proximal to this, you can take the NT distal to it, add them, divide by two, that is one method. Or else the best is that to call the patient at another time or for the next visit. Now this is the master himself. Let's see what future is installed. This is Robin Chui. We attended this international webinar last week only. Now we have indirect hints, as I told you. There is thickened NT, there is tricuspid regurgitation, there is DV reverse flow, there is abnormal cardiac access. More than that, we should be doing situs, we should be doing four chamber view in grayscale, we should be doing four chamber color view, and we should be seeing three vessel outflow views. Now, four images on the screening can detect most complex heart anomalies in the first trimester: situs, four chamber grayscale view. Now, this is four chamber ventricular view. Now, if you see it, I'll just tell you the reason for this. If you see, we are standing here, our probe is here, and the blood is flowing towards our probe from this side. So this is red. And again, when the outflow track, the blood is flowing away from our probe. So that is why there is color difference. Basically, there should be a color reversal whenever you are screening the patient. And that is what we are doing in our setup at Manipal Hospital's Dwarka. We are regularly following, this is a 12-week, 6-day fetus. We are regularly doing this. We see the ventricles, we see the ventricular inflow, the outflow tracts are in blue. I know that we are safe in the cardiac aspect. I also do this. We try and see the track, the renal arteries. I know both the renal arteries are there. I know in future, probably I won't have a renal anomaly. So we are trying to be more intelligent, be more futuristic with all the scans. Now this is 3 = sign. Now this you won't find anywhere because I have coined this term. I use 3 = in NT scan. The first one is, of course, the nasal bone is equal to. I use this. I have to see this is equal to. I won't leave my patient unless I see this. The second is equal to is integral translucency. Again, I have to see this is equal to. If I don't see it, I'll recall my patient. I'll scan the patient again and again. But I need to see this also. And third one is, of course, mucoid translucency, which we are bound to have, bound to see properly. It takes a lot of immense practice. It takes immense patience to get this image. This image is very difficult to get, but then you have to get it because we are doing a proper NT scan. Again, you can see this. It's just a thing that the hands of the fetus are normally open in the first trimester. And we can very well see this in all the patients. I thank you for your patient hearing. Thank you.
Thank you all. I hope now we all are wiser as for attaining to our first trimester screening, including the dual marker plus the early anomaly scan. Thank you.